I want to thank the Ukrainian-Canadian Congress for having me here at your triennial. It has never been more important that we come together as leaders, as Canadians, and as Ukrainian-Canadians. Thank you, Alexandra, for your leadership. Our government is grateful for all of your advocacy and what the UCC has done for Canada and for Ukraine. Je suis heureux que tant de membres de notre gouvernement puissent participer à ce congrès, dont la vice-première ministre Freeland, les ministres Anand, Sajjan et Vandal, et des membres du caucus comme Yvonne Baker, Jim Carr et Terry Goodugood. Je veux aussi souligner la présence de l'ambassadrice ukrainienne au Canada, Yulia Kovalev, en plus de notre ambassadrice en Ukraine, Larissa Galatsa. Je remercie bien sûr la première ministre Stephenson de nous accueillir ici au Manitoba. C'est toujours un plaisir de vous voir. And thank you for welcoming us to Winnipeg, Mayor Gillingham. Congratulations again, Scott. It's wonderful that this be one of your first official, unofficial, because I know you're still mayor-elect, but it is wonderful to see you, and it's going to be great to work with you over the coming months and years for the benefit of Winnipeggers, Manitobans, and indeed all Canadians. 9 months ago this week, Russia launched a brutal and bloody invasion of a sovereign, democratic nation. They violated the post-World War II order and stability that has, for decades, upheld our peace and allowed so many people to prosper. They have murdered innocent civilians. All of you here know this better than anyone. When horrible images flash on the TV screen or in your social media feed, you're seeing places you know all too well. Maybe you lived there once. Maybe your cousin does. Maybe your great-grandparents left these places 100 years ago to come to Canada. Today, all Canadians are learning the names of these towns and cities for all the worst reasons. Bucha, Izium, Irpin. I saw the devastation of Irpin with my own eyes when I visited in May, and I will never forget it, witnessing the homes destroyed and the neighborhoods shattered. Our hearts break for the lives lost, the lives ruined, and the people fleeing to safety. Over 105,000 Ukrainian nationals have arrived in Canada under the special immigration programs we launched in February. Thousands of them arrived and settled here in Manitoba. Canadians welcomed them with open arms because that's just what we do. Refugees and immigrants have joined Ukrainian-Canadian communities like so many of yours that go back over a century. Back then, a massive wave of Ukrainian immigrants came to Canada, many of them to the prairies, and they worked the land. They carried with them generations of expertise on farming wheat and grains and helped make Canada a breadbasket to the world. They helped build this country. These farmers brought these skills with them from Ukraine, a land that, until Putin launched his attack, held and will hold again a special role in feeding the world. But now, as a result of Russian occupation and aggression, many in the affected region don't have the most basic supplies. Canadians and Canada have been there to help since the beginning. Our government has allocated $320 million for humanitarian assistance in Ukraine, with money going to organizations that are providing food assistance, clean drinking water, medical supplies, and mental health supports for children, amongst many other things. On ne peut pas permettre à la guerre barbare de la Russie de se poursuivre. On travaille pour faire en sorte que Poutine et tous ses complices de ces atrocités répondent de leurs actes. En partenariat avec nos alliés, le Canada a imposé les sanctions les plus sévères jamais imposées contre une grande économie, y compris contre la Banque centrale russe. On a imposé des sanctions contre les complices de Poutine, contre les oligarques qui facilitent ses actions et contre les législateurs qui ont approuvé les brutalités commises contre les Ukrainiens. Depuis février, le Canada a sanctionné plus de 1400 individus et entités. And today, I can announce that we are adding 35 more individuals to that list, including influential leaders of the state-owned energy company, Gazprom, and sanctioning 6 energy sector entities. We will continue to tighten the screws on anyone abetting this illegal invasion. And we intend to impose new sanctions on members of the Russian justice and security sectors, including police officers and investigators, prosecutors, judges and prison officials, anyone involved in gross and systemic human rights violations against Russian opposition leaders. Putin's war machine cannot be permitted to act with impunity. Its war crimes cannot go unpunished. That's why we're working closely with the International Criminal Court to support its investigation into the atrocities committed in Ukraine. As part of this, Canada has sent a team of highly specialized RCMP officers to The Hague. Canada will continue to do all it can to hold Putin and his enablers responsible for their illegal and unjustifiable invasion. For 246 days, Ukrainians have endured shellings, occupations, and unbearable human costs. This must end in Putin's failure. While Canada continues to push for justice and an end to the war, it is the brave men and women of Ukraine who are fighting on the front lines every day, and too many are giving their lives. We must never forget that when war broke out, it was everyday people who answered the call of duty. It was young people who should have been sitting in university lectures. It was fathers who sent their children to safety in other countries. Grandmothers who, instead of picking up their kids from daycare, have had to pick up guns. The world has been inspired by Ukraine's courageous and relentless defense. And the advances made during September's counteroffensive were met with astonishment but not surprise, because one thing is certain: only someone who isn't paying attention would underestimate Ukrainians. There, your belief in their rights to freedom, territorial integrity, and a choice in deciding their own future is indomitable. And I want to recognize that they are not just standing up for their freedom. No, they're standing up for all of ours, standing up for all democracies in the fight against authoritarianism. In March, when I welcomed President Zelensky to address Parliament, I told him he was a champion of democracy. He has rallied Ukrainians, he has shrugged off threats to his own life, and inspired us all with his strength and courage. He is extraordinary, he is heroic, he is relentless. One runs out of adjectives, simpler perhaps to sum it up. He is Ukrainian. All Ukrainians fighting this fight are champions. Champions for us all. Entre 2015 et 2022, le Canada a formé plus de 33 000 membres des forces de sécurité de l'Ukraine dans le cadre de l'opération Unifier. J'en ai même moi-même vu l'impact quand j'ai visité l'Ukraine avec mon fils en 2016. Et cette mission nécessaire de formation se poursuit encore avec des centaines de membres des forces armées canadiennes qui forment des milliers d'Ukrainiens courageux pour les aider à défendre leur liberté. On s'est aussi engagé à fournir plus de 600 millions de dollars d'aide militaire depuis février. Cette aide comprend des armes et des munitions anti-chars, des gilets pare-balles et d'autres équipements, des caméras de drones, de la technologie de surveillance et des véhicules militaires. Today, the 39 armored combat support vehicles we announced for Ukraine in the summer began arriving in Europe, where training with the Ukrainian forces is now underway. On a également alloué des millions de dollars pour aider à retirer les explosifs et les mines terrestres que les soldats russes ont cruellement posés sur le sol ukrainien. C'est quelque chose d'ailleurs que Volodymyr Zelensky m'a demandé personnellement lors d'un de nos appels réguliers, et je suis bien content de pouvoir apporter ce soutien pour aider à former, à équiper et à encadrer les Ukrainiens lorsqu'ils procèdent au déminage. Bien sûr, on sait que pour aider l'Ukraine à résister aux assauts de Poutine, ça prend pas seulement de l'aide militaire. The Ukrainian government needs financial resources in order to support Ukrainians and withstand Russia's ongoing attacks. Since the start, we've been working with international partners to effectively flow money to Ukraine. Canada has been leading the charge, both in terms of the scale of support and of how quickly it has been provided. The government of Canada has provided approximately $2 billion in loans to the Ukrainian government this year. But we know, including hearing regularly from Alexandra, that there are a lot of Canadians who would like to see us do more and to be able to do more. We see it. We see it every day in the Ukrainian flags flying from car windows, painted on lampposts, or hanging on front lawns. Well, we want to give all Canadians a chance to directly support Ukraine. So today, we are announcing that Canada will be offering a new government-backed Ukrainian sovereignty bond. Canadians will now be able to go to major banks to purchase their sovereignty bonds, which will mature after 5 years with interest. It'll be a lot like the Government of Canada bonds people are familiar with. These funds will go to support the government of Ukraine so they can continue to support the Ukrainian people. There are hard days ahead, and not just for Ukrainians, as they enter the 10th month of this conflict. The Kremlin's reckless violence has led to widespread economic uncertainty and a spike in global inflation. The Russian regime has weaponized food and energy, which is causing hardship around the world, especially for the most vulnerable. Winter will be particularly hard for our allies in Europe, as the sharp reduction in Russian energy imports has left many people worrying they will be left in the cold. Democratic leaders around the world are standing steadfast with Ukraine, but of course we see the stress that this is putting on people's daily lives. I know Canadians are tired of the sticker shock at the grocery store as food prices go up. We know it's hard. So we're moving forward on legislation that will provide relief for Canadians' pocketbooks. A GST credit arriving in the coming weeks that will help 11 million Canadians. Ensuring dental care for all kids across the country. And more support for low-income renters. These measures will help. But times are tough. But like Ukrainians, Canadians will not waver in our resolve to stand up to Putin. Because imposing hardship is what bullies like Putin try to do. They try to sow chaos. They try to weaken our resolve. We cannot and we will not let that happen. Il y a beaucoup de désinformation qui circule. Et cette désinformation est partagée de manière délibérée par Poutine. Le Canada collabore avec des partenaires du monde entier pour surveiller la mésinformation et la désinformation, notamment avec le mécanisme de réponse rapide du G7 qu'on dirige. Le mécanisme a pour rôle de renforcer la coordination pour cerner les menaces étrangères à la démocratie et d'y réagir. On doit tous rester vigilants et dénoncer les mensonges et les injustices. Et on doit rester fort, peu importe ce que les dictateurs essayent de faire. On va toujours tenir tête aux tyrans qui essayent de faire peur aux autres avec de l'intimidation. I will be going to this year's G20 summit. One of my main objectives, alongside our closest friends, will be to rally our allies and ensure that the world holds Russia to account. The many, many conversations I've had with leaders from Africa, from Asia, from South America over the past many months to highlight the need for the world to stand united have been difficult because we know Russia continues to use all means at its disposal to threaten and pressure the world into silence as they continue their unconscionable attacks on a sovereign, independent people. But I will tell you that the conversations I've had, even with folks who are wary about being aligned too much with the West, when it comes to the principles of territorial integrity, sovereignty, the rights of any people to choose their own future, to not be attacked and invaded by their neighbors, resonates. And as the food and energy crisis continue, as countries in the global South continue to see Canada and other friends of theirs stepping up to ensure delivery of food, energy supports, investments for the future. More and more countries are coming to realize that Putin must fail. We cannot let him take us all backwards to a bloodied world where might makes right. Depuis le 24 février, Poutine a sous-estimé l'Ukraine. Et il a sous-estimé la force et la ténacité de leurs partenaires et amis. Le Canada est solidaire des démocraties et de ses partenaires du monde entier dans la lutte contre l'autoritarisme. We will not back down. We are here for the long term. We will stand with Ukraine, whatever it takes, as long as it takes. Canada has the second largest Ukrainian diaspora community in the world, with almost 1.4 million people who proudly claim Ukrainian heritage in our country. But we share more than just deep and abiding people-to-people ties. We stand together in the fundamental belief in freedom, in democracy, in justice, and of course, in the inevitable, but sometimes difficult, triumph of light over darkness. Slava Ukraini! Героям слава!